Rev up your engines!
If four-wheel drive isn't enough, you can get a Mercedes-Benz G63 AMG 6x6. Yes, it is six-wheel drive, 577 horsepower. If you're a rich man and you want something to go with your fleet of Mercedes to go off-road, now realize the sticker price of these things are $515,000. But, I mean, if you've already got a jet plane and a few mansions, maybe a island in the Caribbean, why not add the G63 6x6 to your collection so you can go off-roading in a six-wheel drive Mercedes that actually has a pickup bet on it. There's a guy in Florida who saw one now for $975,000 that's been modified even further. If you don't mind spending about $1 million on one, Corey the Fam says, Scott, is it worth restoring the 1995 Chevy 1500? Depends on how much money you want to spend and what you want to do with it. They were solid built in those days. You get a V8 engine in them, they were solid built, they could run a really long time. If you want to restore it and use it as a fun vehicle to drive around with yourself, go right ahead. Don't put a ton of money in it and restore it to original OEM specs with all new paint and new everything, because it's never going to be worth that much money. They made hundreds of thousands of those things, and they're never, ever going to be collector's items. So don't put a ton of money in it. But if you want a reliable truck and you can find one that the frame and stuff isn't rusted on it, it could last you a lifetime if you want to keep it up. You know, it all depends on what you want to do. Just don't put a fortune and think I'm going to restore it and sell it to somebody for a lot of money. It'll never be a collector's item. So it'd be a great truck to restore for driving around. You can keep for a long time if you want to do that. Just don't throw too much money into it. Of course, that said, prices of new ones can be $45,000 to $50,000. So if you buy something like that, even if you put new engine, transmission, rear, and everything, and put maybe 10, 15 grand into it, it's a ton less than a new truck. It's going to last a lot longer than that, too. To Seth Ahmed says, Scotty, thoughts on lease takeovers? If you can get a good deal on a lease takeover, sure. The problem is, generally a lease takeover, you're going to pay too much. Unless it's the second or third lease, and it was a new car, was leased, and then leased again. And if it's a good car like a Toyota, you might get a good price on it. But normally, you will not get a good price on a lease takeover. You'll still be paying too much. You're better just buying it from somebody who had a car that's selling it, because they generally want way too much money for the lease takeover price, and they won't budge on it because there's so much money still owed on the car. CC the Great says, I got an 01 Honda Accord with 400,000 miles. Should I sell it for $3,500? Well, if you want the money and you can find somebody that'll fork out $3,500 for an Accord that has 400,000 miles, go right ahead. I mean, that's a lot of money for a car with 400,000 miles. But if you got a buyer that's going to buy it and you want to get rid of it, go right ahead, because eventually stuff is going to break with that kind of mileage. If I had one, I could get that kind of money, sure. Sell it, because I know I can buy one with half that mileage for less money than that, and I'd just swap them out that way. IR the Gecko S. Scotty, I got a 96 Lincoln Town Car Executive, 4.6L V8 automatic. It's got 222,000 miles. It's overheating. We can't figure out what it is. We put a radiator, thermostat, coolant temperatures on it, recovery tank. It's not leaking any fluid. No smell of coolant. The gauge shows it's overheating, and as soon as I turn it off, turn it back on, it shows it's back at a normal. All right, it doesn't sound to me like the thing's overheating, because it's impossible for you to just turn the car off and turn it back on and the temperature gauge goes from hot to the middle. Actually, if a car is overheating and you turn it off, well, as soon as you turn it off, generally it starts overheating even worse, because that's a heat soak. The fans aren't blowing through the radiator, the water pump isn't pumping the water through the system. Most cars, if you shut them off, turn the key back on, the temperature actually will go up a little bit because it'll have heat soak and it'll get a little bit hotter. So I'm assuming your temperature gauge reading is just wrong. And to check that, it's a very easy thing. You can get one of those infrared non-contact guns for measuring temperature. Now, years ago, they used to be $2,000-$3,000. Now you can get it for $14.95 on Amazon, and they work perfectly fine. Do real temperature readings on a radiator. See what the actual temperature is. Because odds are you got some funky electronic problem on it. Because turning the car off and on again, all that does is reset the electronics. And if it goes from being hot to being in the middle, just turn it off, turn it on, then you got some kind of electronic problem. And if that is, and it's a real cow to figure out, that's a luxury car, and it's the 96, so all that wiring stuff's old. What I'd say is, buy a temperature gauge. You can get a temperature gauge and a sending unit and put it on the dash or anywhere you want to mount it. And that'll give you the actual reading and ignore all the other stuff. Because if you can't figure out, you put a new temperature sensor you set on it, that didn't fix it. Who knows? Could be in a dash. That's one of those digital dash things. just go after Mark and get a temperature unit and a setting unit and a wiring for that thing. You can get it for like 30, 40 bucks and just put that on it. Bypass the old one. I do that all the time in those old things. Vlad PM Tech says, Scotty, I got a $3,000 budget to buy a hatchback. I'm considering a Honda Civic with a manual gearbox. What other cars do you recommend? Well, that's a pretty good choice, but a Toyota Corolla hatchback, the Matrix hatchback, those are excellent vehicles too. You know, there's a lot of decent hatchbacks out there because everybody wants something that rides like a car but has more room to fit stuff in. If you can find a Civic with a manual transmission, that's a really good car because the only problems the Civics ever had were the automatics wearing out eventually. They weren't as bad as like the Accord ones, especially the V6 engine Accords. Their automatic transmissions burned out a lot faster. But a Honda Civic with a manual transmission, if you can find one for $3,000, jump on it because those cars aren't that easy to find. In the United States, 96% of the people now drive automatic transmissions, so it's hard to find used manual gearboxes. Americans are into automatic transmissions. Want to just cruise along, so it's going to be hard to find a manual one, especially used, because at least new, you got a choice. I want a new one with this, and they make them, they can sell you one. But looking used, when they don't sell that money, it's pretty hard to find those things. Next question is Roy Oliver Scotty. What modern OBD scanner has a reasonable price for do-it-yourselfers by early 2000 Mitsubishi cars? I just want to read fault codes and see if any check engine light occurs. The problem with those Mitsubishis is they had a relatively unique diagnostic stuff on board. If you call the Blue Driver guys, they're Canadians, they make a very good little dongle that plugs into your car's OBD port and then you use your smartphone for it. I talk to the guys a lot, they're interesting guys, and ask their tech support if it supports Mute 3 for that Mitsubishi. And they'll tell you, they're very honest guys. They don't lie, they don't make any balonies. And they'll tell you, if it does, go ahead and buy one. I have equipment up here I know works on it, but mine costs $5,000. You don't want to spend that kind of money. So ask those guys. And if they say it does buy it, it's like $99. They're one of the few companies I ever met in my life that said, we give you free updates. And I've had them for 5 years, and the updates are still free. They're not charging for them. I've had so many companies in the past that said, oh, yeah, Scotty, you know, you get free updates for life. And then 2-3 years later, they start charging $800 a year for the updates. So these guys don't. They're honest guys, and they have good stuff. Call them. If they do, and if they do, hey, send me an email, scottykilmer@gmail.com, and say, hey, Scotty, you were right. It does support that, because I'm curious myself now. Sam Marka, 1996, says, Scotty, I got a 94 Corolla 5-speed manual tranny with 228,000 miles. I had all the clutch hydraulics replaced, but every now and then it won't in the gear and reverse grinds. Any thoughts? Yeah, it's time for a new clutch inside the transmission. Gear pedal remains hard. There's no air in the system anymore. And if it's only occasionally, it just means that your clutch is wearing out. The clutch has a clutch disc that's got friction material, then there's a pressure plate that goes over it. And when they just wear out, eventually they don't work right. Even though the hydraulics pushing them, they're so worn that it'll either grind or won't go into gear because the clutch itself is just worn out. If you find that your pedal is always hard, then your clutch is just going out. Now, if when it grinds, all of a sudden the pedal feels soft, then you probably got bad hydraulics. Now, don't think that doesn't happen, because a lot of people will buy these cheap Chinese-made master and clutch cylinders, slave cylinders, and they're not that great, and they just don't work. And then it will be soft, and you'll get a lot of play before it hits. Then, you know, that wasn't fixed right. But if it's still hard and it doesn't go in, it's time for a new clutch. Put a whole clutch kit in it. Don't buy piece or piece. You buy the whole kit for 100-something bucks and replace every piece of the clutch. Michelson Sarmiento said, what books are those behind you? I used to have books all over the place. I'm an avid reader. And my wife said, the books, there's too many books, it's clutter. So she gives them away to the bookstore used down the street. We don't even ask for money. We just get crates of them and give them to them. There are all kinds of books. I mean, when I went to university, there's books, there's car books up there. And I get them free because people always want me to try their stuff out and hope that I talk about them on my videos or here on my live car talk. Because you can't buy me. You can't say, Scotty, what do you charge me to tell me how great this stuff is? I don't charge anything. I check stuff out, and if it's good, I talk about it, and if it's bad, I don't. Or if it's really bad, I'll talk about it and say, don't ever buy this, because it's a bunch of crap. So I used to have a whole bunch more books than that, but we're going away from books these days. I still like reading books, though. I gotta say, I'm reading a book about caves now, about underground caves, and I just just like sitting, reading a book. I don't like reading on a computer screen. It annoys me. I'd rather read solid stuff on a book. Now, data information, I don't mind on a computer. Wiring diagrams, stuff like that, I'll read on a computer. But actual ideas, I'd rather read a book myself. I mean, there used to be all over the place. There's maybe, I don't know, 20% of them left that my wife didn't make me get rid of because they're all dusty. So if you never want to miss another one of my new car repair videos, remember to ring that bell.